Kelly, the ball carrier.
I'm Jeff Grayson. During the next hour, I'd like you to sit back and enjoy the 1985 Traverse City High School football season. It was a great year, and it all began right here just a few short months ago. Tonight, we'll talk to the players and the coaches. We'll even chat with the band and the cheerleaders and some of the fans to find out what went into making this whole dream come.
The city of Detroit and that metropolitan area, and we're going to show them what the hell kind of team we got.
The man at the helm of this banner season, as he has been for the past two decades, was Coach Jim Ooley. Football has been his life since a boy, and with so many years behind him, it's no wonder that when one thinks of football in Traverse City, the name Ooley immediately comes to mind. There are many sides to a head coach that can't always be seen from the sidelines. And for Ooley, the importance of family is one of them.
My dad's involvement with me through all along. And he's was more of a buddy almost than a dad. And he died in 79 after we won the state championship, but he was very proud of all the accomplishments that I had, when I was playing ball in college and playing ball in high school and coaching, all the achievements that we were fortunate to achieve. He was always right there, and I remember one time when I was very young that he was going to teach me how to kick, and he stepped on a brick and sprained his ankle. And he was really a very good friend.
As I sat with Coach Ooley and his family in their living room, it was obvious that this was a family that shows support for each other, much like the Trojan football team of 85.
My dad was the football coach, and I go along with him everywhere he goes, and I have total support with him, and through every season and every year and every game I try to watch or listen to on the radio if I can't make an away game, and I'm just really proud of my father. A few years ago when we went to the Silver Dome, or well, even before that, it was real cold, and so that year I thought I'd make my dad a scarf. And so I made him a black and gold scarf, and he wore it through the cold season right at the end. And then that year he went to the Silver Dome, and so I said, well, you're gonna wear it to the Silver Dome? And he didn't really want to because it was so warm, but he ended up wearing it anyways because he knew he'd hear from me later. And then this year he wore it through the cold seasons again and got towards the Silver Dome, and I asked him if he was going to wear it, and if he wasn't, I was going to take it and swing it around and but he decided he was going to wear it. He thought he'd better. Special guy. Everywhere I go, people are, you know, always telling me, you know, what a special guy and how he helped them, whether it's through school or through the football team. He's as special as at home as he is, I'm sure, at school. I never had him for a teacher or a coach, but he's a very intelligent guy. He knows the game of football very well.
Football has always been very important to him, and he came to Traverse City in August of 53, and I was working in the superintendent's office at the time. And he was new and I was single, and we just started dating a little bit. Our very first date in September of 1953 was going to a football game in Cadillac, watching a varsity football game down there. And Jim at the time was coaching JV football. So I should have known from that time that football was always going to be important. And it has been.
I think religion has always been a very important part of my whole life. I think the commitment that we have to our God is a very important part, and I think the spirit that also permeates our team and our lives, and so it's an important part of everything that I do. The success would start with my wife and the patience that she's had through all these years of putting up with a coach who spends a lot of time. But also I think I receive too much credit for the victories that we have, because it really is a team effort. And the players are certainly are the ones that deserve most of the credit. And we certainly have a outstanding coaching staff. And I would be remiss not to compliment all of them, with not only just the high school, but the junior high coaches and the grade school coaches. And like Doug Lautner says, like the influence that his brother gave him by playing ball with him and the parents, it's really a team effort all the way through. And the community and the players and their parents and the fans all deserve credit for the accomplishments that we've been able to achieve.
When we return, we'll take a look at the first half of the championship game as we relive the dream come true. The Trojans had knocked off 12 opponents over a dozen weeks. Their conquest took them as far south as Ohio. But Saturday, November 30th, was their day at the Pontiac Silverdome against the upstart Colts from Troy, who had knocked off some of the state's powerhouse football teams and had only lost once all year. The Trojans and Colts both had a chance to work out in the Silverdome's artificial turf on Friday prior to the game to get a feel for the turf, the lighting, the temperature, and the dome. And on game day, it was as if both teams had played there all season. And they began to feel right at home when more than 25,000 hometown fans nestled around the huge dome to cheer their kids on. When the Trojans emerged from the locker room, there was only one thought in mind: taking the trophy back home to Traverse City and placing it next to the one that was driven up I-75 7 years ago when Traverse City knocked off North Farmington 20-14. The kickoff was taken by number 10, Josh Feebing, to open up the game, and the battle was underway. He carried the ball to the Traverse City 35-yard line. Senior quarterback Chris Hathaway then went to work for the black and gold. The Trojans have been a running team all year long, and their game plan for the championship was no different. It was evident early on that this was going to be a hard-hitting affair, and every inch was going to be paid for dearly. The first play from scrimmage was a pitch from Hathaway to Josh Feebing for just a handful of grueling yards. The Troy Colts were very tough in the early going. This was a team that wasn't even picked to win their own league this year, but during the season they knocked off five league winners on their way to their first ever Southeast Michigan Conference crown. Consecutive upsets of state-ranked Henry Ford Stevenson and Detroit Catholic Central labeled unranked Troy the Cinderella team of the playoffs. And while the Colts scoffed at that description, they used that anger to take advantage when it came time to strap on their helmets. Trevor City was stopped cold on their first drive and were forced to punt the ball away. As did the Trojans, the Colts' offense experienced the same difficulties moving the ball on their first possession. A beautiful defensive play by a swarm of Trojan defenders sent Troy back to the huddle. With Troy looking for first down yardage on a third down play, the Colts were unable to move the chains as they went straight into the talented Trojan defense. The Colts were forced to give the ball back to the Trojans. Traverse City's Jeff DeRocher fielded the short 30-yard punt and returned it 11 yards to the Troy 45. Looking for the first score of the game, Hathaway hands off to big Tony Olson, who gains 7 yards to put the Trojans inside the 40. But a costly face mask penalty puts Traverse City well into Troy's domain. Chris Hathaway, who only threw one interception all year long, went back to pass, and it was picked off. But Dave Lamb pays dearly for the defensive gem as Chris Hathaway wisely keeps his head up to make the bone-crunching tackle. Troy's next drive was stalled by the Trojans' defense, and the quarter ended in a stalemate. Traverse City's first drive of the second quarter saw number 11, Doug Lautner, dash 31 yards well into Troy territory. The undefeated squad put their youth to work as sophomore Lance Morgan takes a 12-yard pass from Hathaway to put Traverse City on Troy's doorstep. With the crowd on their feet, Lautner then breaks free again for a 9-yard scamper around the right side and into the end zone for a touchdown. The foot of senior Ken Klusterman drills the extra point, and with less than 10 minutes left in the second half, the Colts had their work cut out. John Spinozzi fields the kickoff and heads upfield, only to be sideswiped by junior Tobin Decker at his own 31. Troy quarterback Kurt Schramm begins the aerial attack as he hits John Locker for a big 23-yard gain. With the newly revised game plan, the Colts continue to let the ball fly as Locker plucks another one from the air and the Colts start knocking on the door. As time ticks away, number 24 at 5'8", John Spinozzi, will try to bowl his way into the end zone, but a herd of Trojans corral the running back at the 3-yard line. With the Colts only yards away from pay dirt, Traverse City's defense got ready to dig into the trenches to try to protect the 7-point lead. And with just a little over 6 minutes left in the half, Troy was looking to take a tie into the locker room. But the Trojans' senior Chris Valerio's defensive play pulled the plug on the quarterback and left him sitting in the dark. The Colts settled for 3, and the Trojan lead was cut to 4. Troy's kickoff to Traverse City took a Colt bounce and sent Lautner scrambling to make the return. After Lautner dashed 40 yards, Traverse City had a chance to pad their lead, and the players on the sidelines began to feel the excitement of winning a state championship. Josh Feebing carried the ball into the end zone, but an illegal motion penalty soured the juniors' taste of a touchdown in the Silverdome. This one wasn't called back as Doug Lautner runs off tackle for his second touchdown of the day. The The extra point was up and good, and Traverse City padded their lead 14-3. With 2 minutes left in the half, the Colts were forced to go up above, but sophomore Gary Racken set up his senior comrade, Scott Henry, with an interception that he'll never forget. Seconds before halftime, number 86, Mark DeMeester, plowed towards the end zone for what looked like a sure touchdown that would have put the Colts away. A hard hit at the goal line coughs up the ball, and as you can see on the replay, it was a fumble. The Trojans went into the locker room enjoying a 14-3 lead. When we return, we'll visit the homes of some of the key players to talk with them and their families about the dream come true. There were many outstanding players amongst the storybook team, one of which was Doug Lautner, the senior running back that rushed for more than 1,000 yards. And at only 5'8", he astonished unsuspecting foes with his maneuverability that left the opposition catching only glimpses of the number 11 on his back.
Well, really, my brother worked with me ever since I was like 5 years old. And he always told me all along, it's just, if you just try your hardest and stuff, you'll probably make it. And it just worked out great the way it, you know, our team came together and stuff, because we weren't supposed to make it. No one ever thought we were, but we just never gave up.
I always told the kids and Doug and all of them that if you start something, you're going to finish it. You're not going to drop out in between, you know. So if you don't want to play, don't start it. And I think it's helped the kids a lot to know that they aren't going to drop out if in between. And if you want something, you got to work hard to get it.
What's it like as a parent to sit in a stadium and watch 20,000 people watch your son run up and down the field?
It's scary, but we do a lot of yelling and cheering, and it was great.
And what effect has Coach Ooley had on Doug?
Just to keep cool when you're out in the game, and just to have fun. He doesn't think of it like as a, you know, something you have to do. He tries to make you think like it's just a game and to have fun and to make it last and stuff. So that's probably the most important thing. It helps you keep together during the game.
As for Doug's mom, the Silver Dome was no surprise.
Yep, I expected it. I knew all along we were going.
That's what she always said.
Yeah, I said right from the beginning, you're going all the way. It was sure nice.
I really didn't get to see my parents that much because having games on Friday nights and then doing stuff on Saturday with friends, I don't know, you kind of miss them.
Real proud of him and real great. Yes, good boy.
Complimenting the size of Lautner was the powerful fullback Tony Olson. Big number 44 joined Lautner in rushing for more than 1,000 yards to become only the second player in Traverse City history to carve out four figures.
Very exciting. Couldn't believe it. It was a dream come true.
All the way through the season, I knew they were going to go all the way after the first couple of wins. I just knew they were going to go, and they went for it. I think they saw it too after they won the first couple of games, and they knew they could do it, and they did it.
It was fantastic. It was just a big thrill for me. I just kept thinking what kind of thrill it must be for him down there in the field. It was just fantastic, a fantastic year.
The quarterback is said to be the catalyst of the team, and Traverse City's lucky number this year was 13. And who better to wear that number than Chris Hathaway, the 6-foot, 180-pound senior quarterback. His athletic ability and quick thinking helped the Trojans journey to the never-before-seen 13-0.
It was a team effort. If everybody didn't stick together and play together, it would have never happened. You know, it's the best team ever in the state. 13-0 is the best record ever. It's just a great feeling.
Well, I think it was great, too. It was a lot of fun. I was nervous. I'm always nervous for all the games, but it was fantastic.
You can't thank Coach Ooley and his whole coaching staff. I think they were just at least 50% of the whole season. We think a lot of Coach Wood and Coach Wilson and Coach May, as well as Coach Ooley.
As far as throwing interceptions this year, you only threw two, and you let one go in the first quarter. What did you think when you let the ball go?
Since it was real early in the game, I put it off and just kept it out of my mind. John told me to shake it off, and I, you know, after that, it all fell into place, and I felt good. So if I would have threw four or five incompletions in a row, then I might have had a different attitude towards it.
I think it helped that he tackled the guy that intercepted the ball,
yeah,
too.
Make mention. We've been watching the replays. You hit him pretty good.
Yeah, he was a little off balance, but I don't get too many hits in a year.
What are you going to think about when you look back 20 years from now, when you think about this big season?
I think I'll realize more 20 years from now than I realize now what a great accomplishment our team had, and that there was probably, I don't know, 300 to 500 teams or whatever in Class A. And we were the one that was undefeated and won the state championship. And to think that at the beginning of the season and go through the whole season and just have a great season, it was just unbelievable. It's something that I can look back on and just think, you know, we were the best. And nobody else could take that away from us.
I was born in a small town, and I live in a small town. Probably down a small town of the small communities, and all my friends, it's a small town. My parents live in the same small town. My job is a small town, provides little opportunity. Educated in a small town, taught to fear Jesus in a small town. Used to daydream in that small town, another boring romantic, that's me. But I've seen it all in a small town, had myself a ball in a small town. Buried an L.A. doll and brought it to this small town. Small town, just like me. No, I cannot forget from where it is that I come from. Cannot forget the people who really love me. Well, I can be myself here in this small town, and people let me be just what I want to be. Yeah, yeah, yeah. None against a big town, still hayseed enough to say, look who's in the big town. But my bed's in a small town, oh, that's good enough for me. Well, I was born in a small town, and I can breathe in a small town.
Probably down in a small town. Oh, that's just where I
The Trojans' undefeated season was a class act from start to finish. The thousands of fans that had the opportunity to attend the games were entertained by not only the talented athletes on the gridiron, but by a group of more than 100 young people who were very much a part of this championship season.
I think we drew quite a few fans just within the band itself. I mean, I think people came to see us, but I think that combined with the team, it was just a phenomenal year all the way around. We had an excellent season. We were extremely consistent, and so was the football team, and it just combined together to make an outstanding season.
We've had a really exciting year this year, and the kids have done a great job, but probably a lot more than people really realize goes into making the marching band work on the every Friday evening and at the Silver Dome or wherever we're performing. Our actual season starts in the spring prior to the opening of school. In the summertime, we march in the Cherry Festival. And that's quite an undertaking to get that underway. I don't look at the Silver Dome as any more special than any other performance throughout the entire year, as I'm sure Coach Ooley would say too. It's a matter of us trying to do the best we possibly can with the tools that we have all the time.
Everyone was trying. There wasn't any, you know, just like the football team, there wasn't any real superstars. It was just, you know, there never is in a marching band, but it was everyone trying together and just really making it work. You don't really understand how much of an impact it is gonna make on your playing, but it really does. When the crowd is enthused and they appreciate what you're doing, you sense it and you play so much better. You just give you total effort. You can tell by the response that we had at the Silver Dome, and also a couple weeks back at the Flint playoff game, they were just terrific. There wasn't one bad performance, as we've been told by the community, and we've been shown by the community by their, you know, by their efforts and their supporting, and by our director John Campbell. He just, you know, has said every performance has just been very, very good.
Everyone was really enthusiastic throughout the whole season, but it is our job in a sense to keep everyone with high morale and keep them going. But it wasn't really necessary this year. I think a lot of times people got us more fired up than we've got them, because they're just so enthusiastic.
Every season is special because every kid is special, and every group has their own personality. I think the thing that made this season really extra special was that we had an opportunity to perform for people other than the people here in Traverse City. We performed in Flint with the team in Lansing, and also the final performance at the Silver Dome. And I think a lot of people around the state had an opportunity to see our group, and that made it very special.
Another group of kids that displayed their enthusiasm and support while the gold road was being paved to Pontiac was the cheerleaders.
It's probably one of the most exciting things that I could say has happened to me during my high school years. Being a cheerleader is very important, and it takes a lot of dedication, discipline, practice, just pep, enthusiasm. It's a culmination of everything exciting, and even though sometimes it seems like we aren't always appreciated, it's always fun, and it's always something that I'll remember forever with a lot of happiness.
It was just probably the best experience in the whole world to know that we had all of Traverse City behind us and behind the guys, and I'm sure it was a wonderful feeling for them too. You need people behind them in good times and bad, and I'm glad to say that they didn't have any bad times this year, and I really feel it was an honor to be able to be supporting them. and it was fun to get the fans going. There was a lot more school spirit this year, and there was a lot more city spirit this year to be behind the team.
Yes, I was a cheerleader many years ago, and I hope that they look back and say that they had a good time, they enjoyed it, and I hope that they can look back and say they made a lot of friends and they learned how to get along. I think that's one of the biggest things, that they learn how to communicate and get along with people. I was real pleased with the girls at the Grand Blanc game. I saw two of my students waving the towels, and I picked up the idea, and the girls at the following week got on the radio and television, and talked about the terrible towels, bring your gold towels, gold material, and that the Lansing game, it really was productive, and then it kept on for the Silver Dome, and it really looked sharp down there.
You could sum up this year, how would you sum it up, your last year in high school?
Wonderful. It was totally wonderful, and I would not want to spend it any other way.
Coming up, the Trojans and the Colts will return to the field for the second half of the championship game. The Trojans and Colts emerged from their respective locker rooms after the intermission, ready for round two. Although down 14-3, the Colts were far from turning into pumpkins. Despite Traverse City's domination of the contest, Troy remained confident that this would be their half and the trophy would be theirs to proudly display in their hometown, just a few short miles away from the dome where they battled. Not one of the dozen teams Traverse City played this year ever touched foot in the end zone during the third quarter, and it became obvious if Troy wanted the trophy, they'd have to be the first. The Colts' ground game went nowhere in the first half, and quarterback Kurt Schramm was hoping to go to the air on the first drive. But Chris Valerio met Schramm for the second time of the day. Again, the aerial attack was grounded when Schramm looked for number 88, Eric Jenkins. With the Trojan defense proving why they've never let an opponent step foot in the end zone in the third period, Troy had to look to their bench for the kicking team. Jeff DeRocher came up with a ball but could go nowhere. Compounded by the holding call, Traverse City was deep in their own territory. Number 10, Josh Feebing, was denied a touchdown earlier in the day because of a penalty. But this 55-yard gallop downfield was this time greeted by the friendly yellow flags that were brought by the fans. The Trojan coaches then dusted off the playbook for this double pitch back to Hathaway that kept the Colts galloping to save a touchdown. On third down and long, Jeff DeRocher proved why he was All-State material as he dropped to his knees for a pass reception that was just shy of a first down. The Trojan kicking team was called to increase the Traverse City lead by three, but the Colts continued bucking and kept themselves close with still more than a quarter to play. On Troy's next play from the line of scrimmage, a costly illegal motion call nullifies this pass play from Schramm to a senior wide receiver, John Locker. Schramm keeps the ball in flight with this short gainer to 6'5" tight end Scott Maniscalco. The 6-foot quarterback looks downfield in an attempt to keep the Colts alive. With his receivers all accounted for, he runs for his life and turns the play into a first down. John Locker plucks the pass from the air to keep the third quarter march towards the end zone intact. After being stalled on the next three plays, Troy brought out the punting team, but instead they gambled and the cards came up aces. The Colts were only 23 yards away from being the first team all year to walk on the turf of the Trojan end zone in the third quarter. But those lucky aces quickly turned to jokers just as fast as the cards were dealt. The fumble recovery by Jeff Campbell put a lull over the Colt bench that was deafening. The opening of the fourth quarter was owned by big number 44 Tony Olson as he broke home to the end zone to dash the Troy dreams of winning a state championship. Trojans faked the extra point, and Jeff DeRocher had more than enough reason to show us the DeRocher shuffle. Although the Colts were down, they still pulled at the reins and refused to go home without a fight. This highly spirited club continued right down to the last minute to display the zest that earned them a shot at their first ever state title and a chance to play in the Pontiac Silverdome. How ironic that the finishing touches were put on the Colts by some heads-up teamwork, which was a trademark of the 85 Trojans. Marty Lotbell gets a hand on the pass and John Heckroth did the rest. Just minutes before the Trojans would proudly display their second championship trophy in a decade, Hathaway led the black and gold downfield for the last time in 85. For the 28 seniors on this club, the dream had finally come true as the final seconds wound down. For them, this was the last shot at a title. For those who will return next year, it's something to work even harder for. Final chapter of the storybook was written by Jeff DeRocher as he scored the last touchdown. The extra point was the perfect topping for the first ever 13-0 season, and the Trojans won it 29-3.
With a fiberglass sky. They met once more before they said goodbye. 42 men acting as one, determined to come home champions. 6-0,
Traverse City's gonna go for the extra point. Kent Wisterman, good kicker for Traverse City, has ideal conditions to put them through those big bright goal posts at the Silver Dome. And there's a kick Kent Wisterman will remember all his life. Traverse City has the lead. He's still on his feet. He's at the 40. He's at the 30. 25, 20, 10, 5. Touchdown, Tony Olson. He's got himself a 1,000-yard season and his 25th touchdown of the season. Richards swung out wide along with Lautner. Hathaway looked into the end zone. Wide open is Jeff DeRozier. Touchdown, Traverse City. From Pontiac Silverdome, right up 75 North, or hit Ben Clare over to 115, and then come up through Mesick, and a big celebration at Senior High. 10 o'clock tonight, be there to welcome your state champion. Traverse City, Class A state champion. 29-3 over the Colts of Troy High School.
Coming up, the yet unseen reaction of the players and the coaches in the press box just minutes after the big win. Minutes after the celebration, the coaches and the key players were escorted upstairs to the press box for their initial reaction to both the win and the loss.
Give a lot of credit to Troy. They really played hard. They did a lot of good things. But our kids wanted it pretty bad. And I think, again, as in Ann Arbor, I think we won the game in the trenches and we were able to block and move the ball on them and control the ball, and that's part of it. And then the defense, of course, they have a very potent offense. To shut them down to just one field goal is quite outstanding.
Well, we've had a fine season. There's no doubt about that. We'd like to end it on a winning note, and we didn't have that opportunity, and the kids are upset about the game. It's difficult to look past the game to the season at this point because it's an emotional loss. I think in time the kids will realize what type of season they had, what a tremendous accomplishment it's been for a team that has never been ranked in the state and has beaten three of the top 10 teams in the state, and I think that'll come with time. At this point, there's no way I think they can separate the loss from the rest of the season.
Could you have won the state championship without the scarf?
Well, I might have won. We still might have won, but I wouldn't be able to live with my daughter back home who made it for me the first time. So.
Second time.
Yeah, I told the kids, I said, okay, if you think you're high, what the hell do you think I am with this damn scarf on, you know? So we enjoyed it. The kids loved working out yesterday on AstroTurf and just had a good time.
I feel great.
Tell them how big you are.
Oh, I'm about 5'8", 155.
Big man. The only thing they're really big on is heart. That's right. They've just done great.
Well, there's a place in the northern forests where the land and waters meet. 42 men live in this town. They've yet to taste defeat. One more team stands in between the Trojans and number one. This weekend, these 42 men got one more job to get done. They gathered together to play a game in the grass and snow and mud. And down in the trenches where things get mean, they've been known to let a little blood. Last time they faced the pioneers, everybody said they'd fall. Nobody says much in Ann Arbor now. They don't mention the Trojans at all. You may laugh at these backwoods boys from your glass and steel city of Troy. Saturday at the Silver Dome, we're going to separate the men from the boys. 42 men on one sideline will face 42 men on the other. 42 men point to 42 men and say, I'm coming after you, brother. 42 men from the cold north woods, and they're coming for you. Consider this song a warning. You best not be messing around. Saturday at the Silver Dome, there's 42 coming down. And none of them are smiling. They're just coming to win a game. And by the time they walk away from you, you will respect the name. A dozen other teams will tell you what the Trojans are all about. Maybe it's better that you just wait Saturday to find out. 42 men from the cold north woods. And they're hungry. Troy. Next.
I hope you enjoyed tonight's special. I'd like to give a special thanks to my producer, Paul Minster, and to all the wonderful families who welcomed us into their homes. Without their help and support, this wouldn't have been possible. The 1985 Traverse City Trojan High School football season will live forever in the hearts and the minds of the players and the coaches. Indeed, it was a dream come true.
Plastic grass with a fiberglass sky. They met once more before they said goodbye. 42 men acting as one, determined to come home champions.
Six set, I think. Traverse City's gonna go for the extra point. Kent Boosterman. Kicker for Traverse City has ideal conditions to put him through those big bright goal posts of the Silver Dome. And there's a kick. Ken Boosterman will remember all his life. 7-0. Traverse City has the lead. He's still on his feet. He's at the 40. He's at the 30. 25. 20. 10. 5. Touchdown. Tony Olson. He's got himself a 1,000-yard season and his 25th touchdown of the season. Swung out wide along with Lautner. Hathaway looked into the end zone. Wide open is Jester Osher. Touchdown, Traverse City. From Pontiac Silverdome, right up 75 north, or hit Ben Clare over to 115, and then come up through Meesig and a big celebration at senior high. 10 o'clock tonight. Be there to welcome your state champion. Traverse City, Class A state champion. 29-3 over the Colts of Troy High School.
Tonight's presentation was brought to you by Mainstream Sports. True Value Hardware Stores, more than just a name, it's our way of doing business. And by Farm Bureau Insurance Group, Traverse City Electronic Supply, Grand Traverse Auto, Front Street, downtown Traverse City, and wishing you a very happy holiday, Munson Medical Center. The preceding has been a special presentation of TV 7 and 4 Sports.